Has anyone ever gotten cold beer for Christmas? I guess there are some variations. I know some people in the world like that Lumen or something that gets cold just as a joke or something. Santa Claus is kind of an entitlement, but there are more stories in the 19th century where actually Santa Claus was watching your every step during the year, and you had to be so moral in order to get presents. And Easter Bunny encouraging a little bit more initiative, perhaps, of the child. But kind of nice family activities, bonding together, family. A popular child's book of this time, translated by Mark Twain, coming from Germany, was known as Slovenly Peter. And reading it today, we're kind of shocked by those stories. So in one case, Slovenly Peter doesn't want to, have his hair cut or nail cut, and becomes kind of like a recluse. Augustus doesn't want to eat his soup in another story, and he shrivels up and dies. Another story, a boy always wants to suck his thumb, and his parents tell him, don't suck your thumb, he still sucks his thumb. Don't suck your thumb! Well, in the final episode of the story, a deranged tailor comes into their home with their great tweezers, and he cuts off both of his thumbs. So there's like terrible, terrible endings to people not, being moral enough in this time. So they're bringing the kids up. Schools tend to be very moral. Again, you have this kind of coagination effect. You have learning and also reading the Bible, the King James Bible in school. Prayer is in school, unlike our post-1962 public schools where you're not supposed to do that. And what amazed me about one study I did, Muncie, Indiana, kind of a Middletown, USA, which had a lot of southern and northern influences in it, is just how built up the schools were. And of course, a lot of the working class kids weren't going to school. The number of working class children doubles, who are kids that are actually working, like three-year-olds working. More like 10-year-olds or 12-year-olds, like little Andrew Carnegie. That's doubling. 60% of working class income is children bringing in the income, not going to school. But the schools are kind of centers for this middle class morality. And so in a town like Muncie, Indiana, you've got the high school with an iron grade fence all around it. And you've got like this huge tower with a mansard roof, a big clock, big tent roofs, raised basements of these schools. One of the primary schools of Muncie, Indiana, this is when per capita income was less than one-fifth of what it is today, and they have like this huge classical statuary, a loaco in itself. It's like they're trying to teach their children all this kind of classical literature and Latin and Greek and high morals. The Victorians are also big on bringing in the high school. Now actually the high school will tend to change the Victorian culture. You start having young people coming to the same school, meeting one another now outside the church. But the Victorians at first think the high school is going to be a great thing because it'll keep the kid home longer. So they'll be under more moral influences for a longer period of time rather than just having the kid leave home as a 15-year-old apprentice, just getting down the street and doing anything. He's going to stay in the schools. Well, as the children leave home, it may well be that the parents have a chance to further reinforce the moral character of the society by joining some sort of association, as these are also big. It's interesting that the largest female association of the time is not a suffragette group, that is, women aren't interested in the vote yet, but it's the Women's Christian Temperance Union, the WCTU. Formed in 1874. Does anyone know what was this organization? It was talked about a little bit in chapter 20, Women's Christian Temperance Union, our textbook. It has to do with fighting against alcohol. Temperance, not drinking alcohol. A woman that kind of symbolizes this coming together of science and religion, this coagulation, this Carrie Nation. She was very much a sign of the Victorian times. She does have a little insanity in her family, so she is a little, you know, unusual. She is about 180 pounds of pure bulk, so she had some more unusual physical characteristics. But she has one husband by the name of Dr. Gloyd, who kind of brings her into the whole scientific viewpoint of the time. John Harvey Kellogg is in this and everything. But then she has another, but then he dies, and she has another husband, David Nation, who's a minister. So she's getting like this post-millennial scientific world kind of viewed in her. But she also becomes a kind of fanatic, a moral fanatic. And in 1900, in Medicine Lodge, Kansas, she begins to up her ante of her act. She starts taking an axe into saloons and starts attacking them. Starts, you know, actually starts destroying, you know, all the bottles and ripping up stimulating prints from the walls and like emptying out the place. It was one time said that Carrie Nation, having, you know, big muscles, was able to rip off a cash register, which were built for the time to be unportable, ripped it off and threw it at the bartender. She was arrested many times, and yet it was perhaps part of the gallantry of men at that time that they, no one tried to beat her up or actually shoot her or kill her. She was put in jail several times, but she said she wanted to be a martyr to the temperance cause. She had a weekly magazine at one point, the Weekly Smasher with an X as its, you know, key logo. She was popular among a fringe group of the WCT, not the main group that said she was too radical. But nevertheless, here was a sign of the times, Carrie Nation, a woman that would have thought maybe off her rocker if she tried that kind of thing today. Just a few more examples here before I close about this kind of coagination thing and how people, once they were grown, to reinforce the moral order. A notable thing about the late 19th century was the disappearance of pornography. The disappearance of pornography? Well, it was funded by J. Pierpont Morton, an anti-porn. Can you imagine Bill Gates funding an anti-porn speech? But in any case, we had this leader of the Young Men's Christian Association. So this guy was a Christian association, very well educated. Anthony Comstock of those kind of Burnsides, kind of like Chester Arthur, the president. And Comstock actually gets a position with the U.S. Mail Service to stop the mailing of pornography. But before this, as a former Civil War veteran with limbs the size of tree boughs, big, big, husky guy, he would go to these street vendors in New York City who sold what were called French postcards, which might have, you know, this kind of risque picture of a woman still clothed. And Comstock would come up to this postcard dealer and say, I like this a lot, but do you have something that's really filthy? I want something that's really filthy. And then the guy said, okay, yeah, sure, come home, maybe show him, you know, so maybe some nude women that he had on the wall for a special price. And then Comstock would take up his handcuffs and lock the guy up and take him into jail and do a kind of citizen's arrest. The guy was maimed several times, but actually they do come close. They shut down, thanks to Comstock and Morgan and others, they shut down four printing presses, which they thought were producing pornography in the late 19th century. So it's like there's no pornography. As they're shutting all this down, thanks to the vigilance of people like this. And finally, someone who's a little more closer to home, our most famous Denison ever from Northeast Texas, I would say, the most influential Northeast Texan of all time. And he's easy to remember because he's from Morris County. He was born in what was later would be called Naples. Actually, Wheatville, which was before Naples, just a little bit away from Naples. But he was from Morris County. Let's remember that. Morris Shepherd. He has a father who is a congressman. He's very well educated. Goes to the University of Texas, goes to Yale, comes back to Northeast Texas, lives in Texarkana. But still has land in Morris County. But he becomes a senator of Texas, and he is the one who joins up forces with the Anti-Saloon League, founded in 1893, and the Women's Christian Temperance Union, who he absolutely adores, and who puts all the pieces together, writing the 18th Amendment to the Constitution, making the country dry. This is our legacy of Northeast Texas, everyone. We made the country dry. No. Morris Shepherd was the guy that got alcohol off. He put 200,000 saloon keepers out of work. Can you believe that? Our legacy of the world. From 1920 to 1933, it was against the law to manufacture liquor in our country. Good old Morris Shepherd was responsible. So he's a really good example of this kind of scientific mindset. He said he learned about alcohol first in his biology textbook at the University of Texas. But he was also a Methodist convert, very much a post-millennial, who when he got prohibition, said, "This is the greatest thing that has ever happened in the history of mankind since the fall of Adam and Eve in the garden. Because this is going to be a great panacea. Prohibition would just, you know, unleash man's capabilities. We wouldn't have slums anymore." Well, we'll talk a little bit more about that, but this is kind of like the Victorian dream of Morris Shepherd, our man from Northeast Texas. So you can kind of see that there is just this peculiar moral configuration. I'm trying to show that it was a kind of a combination of science and religion. Unusual figures like John Harvey Kellogg, you can remember by the Kellogg's cornflakes symbol. We've got, of course, Carrie Nation, the saloon girl that attacks with a hatchet. Anthony Comstock, anti-porn leader, as well as many other examples, such as doing the corsets, and, how they masked various words like sex, pregnant, using in sun for pregnant, and social for sex. Any comments or questions about then this more moral age? All right. Well, does anyone have any final questions about what you're going to do now?
So what I'd like you to do then is take out a sheet of...